This is the first section of the lecture, Wallace Stevenson, the virile poet, from Hölderlin to Goethe, Ganymede at Troyes. And this contains a, if you like, epigraph I want to offer first, because that's really important for the entire lecture as a whole. Everything is rhythm. The entire destiny of man is one heavenly rhythm, just as every work of art is one rhythm, and everything swings from the poetizing lips of the god. And that's cited by Giorgio Agamben in The Man Without Content, and we'll talk about that a little later. The section that I am going through here, we see some of that, from Hölderlin to Goethe, Ganymede à Troyes, looks at the romantic tradition, although there are those who will argue with good reason that Hölderlin did not belong to that tradition. The 20th of March, 2020, was the 250th anniversary of the Swabian poet Friedrich Hölderlin. You see there, born 20th March, Waffen am Neckar, died on the 7th of June, 1843, in Tübingen. A year later, Nietzsche would be born on the 15th of October in Röcken in Saxony. Now, in the world of arts and letters, anniversaries like these, 250th, very round numbers, are highly contested affairs. Important festivals are organized to which only the right personages are invited to speak. The crisis of COVID-19, quite ongoing as it is, changed all that. But in truth, even without a crisis, change there would have been. The cast of those who might have been considered the right personages always changes, suggesting that possibilities shift and that margins have been pushed. And an innocent observer could get the sense that borders have been extended to include new and younger experts, though it has to be emphasized that the new and the young are always privileged swords. Now, at the same time, one can also come up short, and that can be one way to read complaints about lost value, as Theodor Adorno and Max Horkheimer muse with respect to the commodity character of art. And festivals are designed to exemplify the character of art as a consumer good, that's their phrase, which they use in their dialectic of enlightenment to reflect on Beethoven, Die Wut, über den verlorenen Christen, improvising rage for a lost penny. Another kind of loss, not unrelated, is repeated in Heidegger's On the Way to Language, which Heidegger retrains over and over again from Stefan Georg's 1919 poem, The Word. Where word breaks off, no thing may be. In a game of knots, the silence imposed on alternate voices, those are the ignored, the disregarded, the unnoted, vies with all the other silences and the emptiness of vanity in comprehension, in attention. Now, in what follows, I'll be talking about philosophy and poetry, and although I've already referred to the German poets, Hölderlin and Georg, I'll be reading an American poet who was, for his part, keen on Heidegger, keen being the best word here, Wallace Stevens. You see Stefan Georg and Hölderlin there. Where's Stevens? There he is. By beginning with a reflection on Stevens' epithet for Hölderlin as virile in his 1943 Mont Holyoke lecture, The Figure of the Youth as Virile Poet. Here's the young Wallace Stevens and, of course, the old Wallace Stevens. I seek to foreground a question that typically remains unmarked, swept as it is in the assumption of the masculinity of the voice under the rug of conventionality, supposedly fallen from favor, but of course still with us. For this reason, we still say all men are created equal. The cliché force of this matters where civil rights are currently compromised, sometimes with fatal force for the public health. The focus on men is explicated by scholars, traditionally, sometimes still, as innocuous, as always already having referred to or included both men and women. To be sure, the Greeks, from whom we take our notions of both rationality and liberty, were clear that this applied to men, not to women, and at that, only to some kinds, citizens, often limited to those born to property classes. You can see the property these Greeks are bearing, carrying with them, supposedly one could think illustrating the cave, but there is, of course, in addition to their property, a warrior to defend their claim to those bits, those goods of ownership, like the pre-Platonic philosopher, who focused on, of course, a nous, Anaxagoras. You can see his name there in the book next to his papers. As we can also recall Socrates, these philosophers had friends with benefits, meaning power or wealth. In the case of Pericles, you see that is Pericles there, along with Anaxagoras, or Plato, a friend or student of Socrates. When we talk of philosophy, the love of wisdom, the ideal friendship of those dedicated to ideas as such, to beauty, to goodness, to truth, we're describing an ideal community of friends. Women are not going to be friends in that ideal sense. And it took Jacques Derrida to spell this out for us. Women do not count in this collectivity. Speaking of the politics of friendship as the politics of philia, one of the rare places Derrida invokes without naming her by name, Simone de Beauvoir, we read, "What relation does this domination maintain with the double exclusion we see at work in all great ethico-philosophical discourses on friendship? On the one hand, the exclusion of friendship between women. On the other, the exclusion between a man and a woman." Right, you can see that division. "This double exclusion," he continues to say, "of the feminine in this philosophical paradigm would then confer on friendship the essential and essentially sublime figure of virile homosexuality." Derrida need not name Beauvoir. These ideas are henceforth to be read through his lens only. To mention her name would shift the game. And philosophy stands out among the fields of sciences like psychology, economics, sociology, in that philosophy is chary of citing other research, writing as if one had just now, this very minute, thought of everything. No footnotes, please. We are doing original philosophy, no history. By not mentioning Beauvoir, Derrida only does what serried waves or generations of feminist scholars have also done in their turn. The tactic of non-mention may be especially developed in philosophy, but it's as old as scholarship, advanced going back to Aristotle and Plato, and taken up over the years as no one less than Newton writes, in order, as it seems, to justify forgetting both of them under the guise of a higher. The higher is obvious there, you see, it's the universe itself. Dedication to truth, amicus Plato, amicus Aristoteles, sed magis amica veritas. Duly bracketing Derrida, the same reference to friendship recurs. We see him here in Alexander Nehemas's book on friendship. There he is with Tracy Strong. We visited him at the University of Princeton University, we call it, right? And there he is with his periphilias. And Nehemas himself turns the reflection on friendship, still very male-oriented, back to Montaigne. Speaking of Hölderlin, as we could say, in his The Figure of the Youth as Virile Poet, Stevens was talking in a time of war and danger to an academic audience far removed from either. And it's there, arguably, that language can be most exciting. Thus, Larry Kramer, Lawrence Kramer, writing on sexuality in Schubert, reminds us via Schiller of Friedrich Welker's complicated invocation of the higher love. That is the love of what Friedrich Nietzsche, different Friedrich, will celebrate as the active and creative masculine artist, as opposed to the reactive spectator's artist, proper to the feminine aesthetic as such. Now, Cramer reads Goethe's Winckelmann and His Age, published in 1805, quite in the context of Weimar classicism. Cramer does not here mention, though I might want to do so, the beauty of Goethe's young friend, the astonishing lyric and dramatic poet and theorist of the aesthetic, no less, should we have need more, Friedrich Schiller. Here you should see the Goethe, but also behind them is the opera house in Weimar. And we see Schiller here for his youth and appeal. I say, of course, because I myself seek to go beyond male desire, as Cramer speaks of this, to consider, as I do, male and female desire in a book I wrote just to try to work that out, The Hallelujah Effect. By bringing up the difference between the male and the female, even Nietzsche foregrounds this contrast in his discussion of Goethe's ewig weibliche, in Nietzsche's second untimely meditation on the use and disadvantage, Nachteil, as the German of history for life. And one may add, as of course Cramer does, Schubert as well. But I here am calling attention to the physicality of the poet. Schiller was, as Hölderlin was, and you can see that here, a beautiful man. I want to take care to emphasize that this is my emphasis, complete with the association with Nietzsche and Welcke. It's not what Cramer himself was emphasizing. Cramer's concerned to work out what he names the Ganymede complex. Thus, his reference to Friedrich Welcke and to Goethe, and specifically to Schiller's On Naive and Sentimental Poetry. The beauty of the poet is a little beside the point for Cramer, although his focus is homosexual desire, crucial for both Goethe, who writes a poem, Ganymede, 1774, and for Schiller, to be read if I myself would extend the reference to Hölderlin via Aether, talking about that a little later, to be sure, in terms of the Goethean principle of ascent, and that's how we get to Schubert, as a vertical, and as Cramer argues, a virile figure. He writes, it appears as the awakening of virility in Ganymede's character, familiarly conceived as the principle of action, and the discovery that virile love seeks a virile partner. The ascent thus replaces a supine receptivity with upward striving, the nightingale's call of love, and you see Jessie Norman here, Schubert Ida, with Ganymede's own, and the mother's breast with the father's. Now, in his own poetry, Hölderlin inclines such verticality in a reflex as complicated as his rhythm, and not unlike John Milton's pensive interruption of his own lyric line in his poem to his own higher esteemed friendship with a drowned colleague, his Lycidas. But oh, the heavy change. Now thou art gone. Now thou art gone and never must return. Hölderlin's Ganymede thus closes with that turn, that change. And I'm gonna first cite the German. The English will be given in turn. Der Frühling kommt, und jedes in seiner Art blüht. Der ist aber ferne, nicht mehr dabei. Ihr ging nun, denn allzu gut sind Genien. Himmlisch Gespräch ist seine nun. I have for a while been reflecting on Hölderlin's father, Aether, and it matters that Heidegger cites just this final verse from Hölderlin's Ganymede, published, as Heidegger notes, toward the end of 1804, with other poems dedicated to love and friendship. Thus, I repeat, now in Will McNeill and Julia Ireland's translation of Heidegger's lecture course on Hölderlin's Mnemosyne, I'm only going to change one word. Spring is coming, and everything in his own way blossoms, but he is far away, no longer here. He has gone astray for all too good, our Jenny. Heavenly talk is his now. Here, Heidegger emphasizes more, and here is the word I changed, than most commentators, the language of errancy. He's gone astray, wandering madness, turns characteristic of Hölderlin in his own dark times. Just a moment ago, I noted Larry Kramer's romantic observation that virile love seeks a virile partner. And it's with this that I turn to Wallace Stevens, mindful as I do so, that writing on poetry and criticism, and in philosophy in general, that's the thematic of my own Hallelujah effect, cannot but involve projection. The same projection is impossible to avoid when it comes to themes as close to male literary scholars and male poets on the theme Stevens invokes for his own part when he speaks of his male poet, his virile. That's how we know poet. Now, male is going to be the term that I'll quote from Stevens a little bit later. I referred just a moment ago to Aristotle's justification of silencing exclusion. Here you can see him with his Nicomachean Ethics and Plato's pointing up at the heavens, at the ideal. We can also, I'm not going to talk about you because I have to talk about the truth, so it's not really my fault that I can't mention you any longer. And Newton took this over as his own, in the same way that Aristotle had already borrowed it from Plato, who used the same tactic for ignoring his own antecedents, including the poets. All of it excused a side effect following a higher dedication to truth. In the next section, I'm going to attempt to mark out a space for Stevens and philosophy, mindful in an age of contestations that to do so is also to transgress. I already named Heidegger. I mentioned the analytic continental divide from the side of the wrong personages as the analytic continental distinction maps onto the space of academic privilege, where colleagues argue, and sometimes good faith, but sometimes in anger, that certain of their colleagues ought not be included, they're no good, or they don't do good work, or things like that. That excluding judgment on the part of philosophy extended to Stevens. How shall we read him?